She was a young grandmother, focused on her family.
If you were a friend or family of hers, there was nothing she would not do to help you.
She was always just jolly and happy.
But a rocky past puts her in harm's way.
She was a survivor of drug abuse.
She was trying to get her life straight.
When she mysteriously disappears, her family is afraid for her safety.
I'm asking God daily, where is she?
Bring her back to us.
But soon, dangerous secrets will be revealed.
I never thought nothing like this would have came about.
She got caught up in it and couldn't break free.
Like, makes your hair stand up.
The dog is like, I needed your help. Help me dispose of the body.
I didn't want to believe it.
August 15th, 2012. It's a quiet night in Mishawaka, Indiana, a suburban Midwestern town of 50,000 just east of South Bend.
It's a sister city of South Bend. They're connected to each other.
It's a nice city. There's parks, recreation, that type of thing.
Over on the south side of town, residents Andre Banks and Gene Weaver are hanging out with family friend, 45-year-old Trina Winston.
The two men were Trina's godbrothers, and they had known her family for years.
Her mom took me in as her child, and I accept them as my parents, and Trina and the rest of the siblings, my brothers and sisters. Me and her family, my family, we just grew tight.
We was just laughing and having a good time, you know.
But around 10:30 p.m., Trina gets a call.
They didn't know who was calling Trina, but as soon as she answered the phone, she ducked into a room and closed the door.
A few minutes later, Trina comes back in and announces to her friends that she's leaving.
Where are you going?
Out with a friend.
And I said, who are you going out with? And she could not look me dead in the face.
At that point, they weren't sure what was going on. Trina was acting very weird and very secretive.
Trina, what's going on?
Nothing. It's fine. I just gotta go.
She said, I'll be right back. I'll be back.
Okay. Be safe.
That's the last words I said to her. Be safe.
Little did the men know that it would be the last time they would see Trina Winston alive. Trina Winston was known for her big heart and bright, beaming smile.
She was a very kind person. She gave from her heart. And anybody that needed something, if she have it, she'd give it to them.
If you were a friend or family of her, there was nothing Trina would not do to help you.
The single mother had raised three beautiful daughters with the help of her loving family.
She was pretty tight with her family and her circle of friends. Wonderful mother, fun-loving person.
She would spend as much time as she could with them.
She made sure her kids were always taken care of. Her daughters loved her, and all three of them looked just like her.
And at the age of 45, Trina was embracing a new chapter in her life as a grandmother.
She had her first daughter at a young age.
She was pretty young to be a grandmother, but her daughters had started having children of their own.
How you doing?
I'm doing good.
Her oldest daughter needed help, somebody watching the kids so she could work. So she went and, you know, she stayed with them a while.
Behave, girls.
Okay.
Y'all enjoying the puzzle?
Yes.
But the bright future for Trina and her family came on the heels of a dark past.
She was a recovering addict.
The financial stress of raising three kids alone had taken its toll, and Trina had turned to drugs to cope.
Her daughter's father was never really in the picture.
She was kind of hurt, you know, and she got kind of stuck in using, trying to numb herself. Sometime it gotten to where it was just time. You know, we're getting older, you know, we need to do this, you know. And even though I know a person or anybody, if they're not ready, they're not ready.
Finally, after years of relapses, Trina seemed to be in a better place.
I would give her that encouragement, you know, and hug her and talk to her about, you know, I'm there for you no matter what.
Things were looking brighter for Trina. And in the summer of 2011, they kept getting better when she ran into an old high school classmate, 48-year-old Terrence Lee.
They met just in the street somewhere.
Terrence, is that you?
Trina?
It's been years. You look great.
I thought, you know, Terrence was a real nice person. He was a good, real good basketball player. Very good. He was very popular in school. Everybody liked him. The girls loved him.
I knew Terrence Lee all my life. We lived down the street from each other. My sister got involved with him. They were high school sweethearts for a moment.
Despite the 30 years since they dated, Trina couldn't deny the familiar butterflies.
What are you up to these days?
Same old thing.
He was really in the community, you know, teaching kids how to play basketball at a center, you know, or at a church, preaching.
Like Trina, Terrence also appeared to be in a new phase of his life after a checkered past.
Something happened where he got in trouble with the law.
Terrence went to prison.
There was a lot of things that went down with drugs and, you know, it's just a lot of things that happened.
But with his rocky past behind him, Trina was instantly attracted to the man Terrence had become.
I haven't seen you in a while. Maybe I can get your number. I'd love to take you out to dinner. We can catch up or something.
Sure.
Yeah, just put it in.
She really liked him, and that was it. That was why they connected.
All right, cool.
Soon, the flirtation turned into a whirlwind romance.
She just had this smile about, you know, I have someone.
She fell in love with him. There's a reason why she wanted to be with him. And when he was treating her that way, things were wonderful.
Then, less than a year after reconnecting with Terrence, the couple took a huge step in their relationship.
She said, me and Terrence just got married. I said, Trina! And she said, it's okay. We're going to do, you know, we got a church and we're going to do this. And, you know, he's going to be the pastor. I'm going to be the first lady. You know, all this stuff, all these goody-goody plans that she thought they had going on.
They got married at the County City Building.
The two were determined to free themselves from their past and stay clean once and for all.
She said, we're working our program. We've gone to meetings. You know, we're positive people.
She was always happy when we seen her.
We were having conversations of, you know, I want to do better. You know, I am doing better.
But now, less than 4 months later, Trina's friends and family find themselves worried sick.
She had left her friend's house late one night and said she'd be right back.
And she didn't come back that night.
I was afraid. She got kind of stuck in something there, you know, the continuous of partying, of using again.
Once detectives dig into the case, they'll discover a love triangle that just may have pushed Trina to the breaking point.
She was blindsided by his betrayal.
She actually didn't know that he was still married.
...45-year-old Trina Winston was embracing life as a young grandmother after years of battling drug addiction.
We went through drug addiction, you know, and we went through, you know, getting clean.
Things seemed to only get better for Trina after reconnecting with her high school crush, 48-year-old Terrence Lee.
They ran into each other on the street one day, and she ended up falling hard.
They formed a relationship. They ultimately got married.
The couple was on the road to redemption after both had had brushes with the law.
He had gone to prison when he was younger, and she was a recovering addict.
She would tell us we've gone to different church outings and circles, and I thought, well, that's wonderful.
But now, Trina Winston is missing, and her friends fear the worst.
We all praying, everything's all right. Wonder where she at, called in, couldn't get a hold of her.
They were hoping she wasn't using again.
Less than 24 hours after Trina went missing, Andre Banks and Gene Weaver decide to speak with police about their missing friend.
She left, and that was the last time they seen her.
She just disappeared?
She left last night, never came back.
Andre and Gene say Trina had been staying at their house the last few days.
She was very tight with the two guys. She called them uncles.
They reveal to detectives that Trina had recently separated from her husband, Terrence Lee, and she was heartbroken.
He had actually gotten another woman pregnant while they were married.
She took it hard.
She was saying she didn't know how to deal with this situation, that Terrence had a baby on the way.
After all the sobriety work she'd done, Trina's friends encouraged her to not let Terrence's betrayal set her back.
We tried to let her know, you don't have to do that, you know. We love you. We want you to, you know, stay here with us. We want you to be safe.
But detectives suspect Trina may have surrendered to her addiction.
Is it possible she's just somewhere coming down?
Maybe. OD?
It's possible. But she's worked so hard.
She was a recovering addict. News that her husband was cheating on her and having a baby with the other woman could have definitely set her off.
Is there anything else that seemed odd?
She did get a phone call. Can't get it out of my head.
She had gotten a call minutes before she left and had hidden a room to speak to that person.
Trina's friends say she came back after taking the call and they could tell she was hiding something.
Where you going?
Out with a friend.
Her friends could not understand the need for secrecy.
Whoever the caller was, they clearly had upset Trina. But the question was, did the caller have anything to do with her disappearance? Detectives make a note to subpoena Trina's cell phone records.
There's a good chance that whoever called her that night knows where she is.
Did you call Terrence to see if she might be with him?
No answer. But they're not really on speaking terms. So I don't think she'd go with him.
Well, what about this other woman?
I don't know much about her.
Detectives wonder if Terrence's other woman could have found out he was married and wanted his wife, Trina, out of the picture.
Do you have a name for this other woman?
It's Sarah. Sarah Callahan.
She lives on North Cedar Street. Trina said Terrence had been staying there with her.
Detectives head to Sarah Callahan's home, hoping they can speak to Terrence and his mistress.
This person is the person of interest. We needed to find out if he is, in fact, responsible for her disappearance or if she is not around.
We also wanted to find out whether Sarah knew anything about what had occurred.
At this point, police don't know what they have. They have a recovering addict who's missing. They're still thinking she may just be on a bender.
But as detectives track down Terrence's mistress, they'll discover something more sinister is at play.
She said that she didn't know he was married.
No.
She seemed a little deceptive, kind of like she wanted to eliminate the competition.
Detectives near South Bend, Indiana, are investigating the disappearance of 45-year-old Trina Winston.
She'd been missing for a few days.
Trina was a recovering addict, and her family feared that she may have had a relapse or worse.
Her friends thought maybe she was hiding something else, the way she took a phone call in another room and then left.
But who had called her? Detectives subpoena Trina's cell phone records to uncover the caller's identity. While they wait, they head to Sarah Callahan's residence, the alleged mistress of Trina's husband, Terrence Lee.
They were hoping to find Terrence there. He had been staying with her.
The timing is suspicious. Trina disappeared shortly after finding out about the other woman.
Yes?
Sarah Callahan.
Yes, and who are you?
South Bend Police. Is Terrence here?
No. Why? What's going on?
What about Trina?
I don't know a Trina.
Terrence's wife. She's missing.
As I said, I don't know a Trina. And I didn't even know he was married.
But detectives wonder if Sarah is hiding something.
It seemed pretty unbelievable that she didn't know about Trina at all at this point.
Detectives press Sarah for her whereabouts the night before.
She said she didn't know anything about Trina, hadn't seen her, didn't know what she looked like, didn't know the relationship, didn't know any of those things. But you don't just take anybody at face value.
Where were you last night?
I was here.
Is there anyone that can verify that?
No.
What about Terrence? Was he here?
No. As I said, I was home alone all night, and I don't have any information for you.
Though detectives feel Sarah knows something more, for now they shift their focus to Trina's family. Back at the station, detectives speak with Trina's sisters, hoping for some information about Trina's relationship with Terrence.
We were so worried when she missed our call this morning. We call each other every day, read the Bible, you know, say our prayers while we drink coffee and talk to each other.
We've been trying to call her all night and morning, and she's not answering.
I just kept calling and kept calling, but I thought it just can't be good.
While Trina's friends had feared that she had relapsed, her sisters suspect something far more sinister has happened.
I think it has something to do with Terrence and his mistress. I think something bad has happened to her.
They knew he had gotten another woman pregnant and was still talking to her. They seemed pretty bitter towards Terrence.
Trina's sisters say Terrence's two-timing ways weren't their only concern. They considered their brother-in-law to be a con artist.
He would go around town preaching and talking to youth like he had changed.
Trina's sisters say everyone was fooled into believing he was a reformed man, but they knew the truth.
He supposed to be a preacher, supposed to be preaching the word of the Lord. You know, that just threw me in, you know, too. I'm like, you know, you're not no preacher.
To me, it was all an act.
Trina's sisters say behind closed doors, Terrence had another side.
He's abusive. She kept it a secret, but he laid hands on her multiple times.
Come back here,
no,
look at me.
I don't, what?
I saw you looking at that guy.
She was getting beat up.
Trina's sisters tell detectives Trina put on a brave face, but in reality, she was terrified.
He was threatening to do something to us. That's the only thing we can think of that would keep her going back to him.
That was the whole thing. And he was doing it mentally, physically, financially.
Thank you, ladies.
Thank you.
In light of this new information, detectives take a closer look into Terrence Lee.
Terrence had been in prison for 20 years when he was younger.
In 1986, he had been given a hefty sentence, but had earned an early release in 2006.
He's a snitch. He turned evidence on a lot of people. He told things on a lot of people, and he worked for the police.
He had helped solve 12 murders.
But it's not the early release that catches detectives' attention. It's the crime.
He was actually a convicted murderer.
If you killed somebody once, then maybe you killed again.
Detectives have just learned shocking new details in the missing persons case of 45-year-old Trina Winston. Her alleged abusive husband, Terrence Lee, is also a convicted murderer.
He had been sentenced to 150 years in prison in the 1980s, but was released after only serving 20 years.
The circumstances of the case run counter to Terrence's new identity as a mentor to troubled youth.
He was in prison before for killing people in the community.
He had been arguing with three individuals about drugs.
The scene erupted in gunfire, and the two men were killed instantly. A female victim was lucky to survive.
She was able to tell the prosecutor's office what had happened to her and who'd done it.
After learning about Terrence's violent history, detectives and officers descend on Trina and Terrence's home with a search warrant in hand.
They came through, cleared the apartment, verified that he wasn't there.
As detectives scour the residence, they see no evidence of foul play.
There weren't blatantly obvious signs that a struggle had taken place in the apartment. No blood or anything of that nature. Bedding cover was collected in the event that, since it was a dark cover, there was some kind of staining or bodily fluids on it that I could not currently see at the scene.
Perhaps Trina really has just relapsed and is in hiding. However, a document found in the couple's closet suggests something far more disturbing.
We located in the closet on the top shelf of the bedroom paperwork by Trina looking to end the marriage.
She was asking for an annulment, and at that time she had conveyed her fear of him and asked for an order of protection.
The protection order reveals a distressing account of domestic violence.
He tried to kill her before.
And I thought, well, who is going to contain this killer that we already, you know, spent court time and money and taxes? I mean, it's just the whole thing kind of shifted my mind to think this is the community that I'm living in. And now my sister and my family is being affected by this act of releasing him and knowing that he was a violent person.
The report details the horrific incident.
The two had been fighting over Terrence's jealousy issues.
Terrence, I'm tired of arguing with you.
Come back here,
no,
look at me.
I don't, what?
I saw you looking at that
no,
guy.
No, I wasn't looking at you. It's all in your head. Guy. It was all in your head, Terrence.
She said all she remembers is that she was arguing with him.
Yeah, no, you were.
He strangled her, left her for dead.
Put her in a plastic bag or threw her in the closet.
She said, and the next thing she know, she woke up and she couldn't move. And that she wiggled and wiggled until she got her hands, you know, loose from whatever was holding her hand. And she reached up to her face because she couldn't breathe. And she said she grabbed it.
When she came to, she had to get herself loose and she took off running.
After the alarming revelation, police are determined to find Terrence and, more importantly, Trina.
They believe Terrence is now on the lam.
The next morning, Trina's phone records finally come through, along with Terrence's.
It seems that he had been the one that called her the night she left after all.
They are also able to establish his current location.
His phone was pinging at his mistress's house, so it seemed like the two of them might be in this together and that she was hiding Terrence.
We went to where the cell phone was being located at through the GPS.
Police descend on the property with guns drawn.
They don't know what they're walking into at this point. They think maybe this couple has done something with Trina, but they don't know what it could be or where she is now.
Stop it, police! Get on the ground!
On the ground, on the ground.
Get on the ground,
get on the ground.
On the ground.
I didn't speak directly with Terrence other than giving him the commands to get down on his knees, place his hands on his head, and handcuffing him.
Terrence is quickly arrested without incident.
He was very compliant. He knew we were there for him. He didn't appear surprised that we were there. He's not unfamiliar with police nor being incarcerated. So there was no shock or surprise, I don't believe.
Officers take Terrence and his mistress, Sarah, back to the station, along with Terrence's car.
It was then taken back to the Metro Homicide garage.
While CSIs pour over the vehicle, detectives speak with Sarah Callahan first.
Why did you lie to us, Sarah?
Lie? Are you kidding me? Look, I don't know Trina. But I do know that Terrence has done something to her. Terrence.
Sarah tells detectives Terrence had come over moments before the police arrived, and she knew something was seriously wrong.
And she asked him, and he said he'd been up all night, he was digging a hole.
What do you mean you've been digging
Don't
a hole?
Don't ask me anything else about it.
He basically told her it's none of her business. Stay out of it.
Terrence, Tell me what's going on. Is this why the police were over here earlier asking me about your wife? Are you married? Tell me what's going on.
Listen.
Sarah says that's when he told her to get ready.
Terrence actually told her, hey, police are going to be here soon. Just be quiet. Don't tell them anything.
Within minutes, police were at her door.
The pregnant 26-year-old appears to be forthcoming, but detectives wonder if she's just throwing the blame on Terrence to save herself.
At this point, they're still not sure if she's involved or not. She could just be playing dumb to avoid trouble.
Look, I don't know how many times I have to tell you. I don't know Trina. And y'all are not about to try to pin something on me because of something that fool did. I didn't even know he was married until y'all told me.
With Sarah denying everything, detectives try their hand with Terrence.
I just want to make sure that we recover her body and we give it back to her family. She deserves that respect. I think you're man enough.
I have no clue what you're talking about. None.
Once in custody, he asks for an attorney and refuses to give a statement.
With Terrence refusing to speak, detectives hope his car will turn up some leads. However, the search fails to yield any clues.
The car and trunk were clean. No blood, hair, anything.
Normally, you've got forensic evidence. The autopsy. This person died from a gunshot. This person died from strangulation. This person died from a knife wound. Here, we didn't have any of that.
We looked for signs of the struggle. We looked for physical evidence. Nothing had been located.
We didn't even have the physical evidence that she was even dead.
Detectives are all but certain Terrence is involved in Trina's disappearance, but they'll need proof. And it soon comes from an eyewitness.
He's like, I need your help me dispose of the body.
He said he saw her laying there cold and stiff on the floor.
You gotta be quick, man. You gotta be quick.
South Bend detectives have just arrested 48-year-old Terrence Lee in connection with the disappearance and suspected murder of his wife, Trina Winston.
Family members have alleged abuse against Trina's husband.
He was just a monster.
He'd been convicted of a murder before.
Detectives have also discovered a document in the couple's home detailing an incident in which Terrence had tried to kill Trina before.
He left her for dead, and he strangled her and put her in the closet, but she got out.
With the ex-con in custody, but refusing to speak, police know they're on borrowed time.
We didn't have someone who actually said they saw Terrence kill her. Our evidence was weak.
The next morning, detectives finally catch a break.
Someone has come forward with information on Trina's disappearance.
Detectives sit down with 43-year-old Steve Willis, a man claiming to be a friend of Terrence's. And he has some jaw-dropping information.
Walk in, she's laying over there on the floor. She's laying on her looking kind of pale, you know, real pale, still.
Detectives ask Steve to start at the beginning. He says on the night of the 16th, he and his two buddies, Drew Allen and Mark Raymond, were drinking in the park.
We were a little behind the park and just started drinking. And Terrence came.
He was a friend of Terrence. He knew Trina because Terrence and Trina had gotten married, obviously, but his connection was with Terrence.
Detectives ask if Sarah was with him.
He didn't know anything about Sarah. He said that Terrence was alone.
Steve says when Terrence arrived, he looked frazzled and started making some outlandish claims.
Man, it's Trina, man. She's dead, bro. What do you mean? What do you think I mean?
He said her body's in my apartment and he needed help to get rid of her body.
Man, stop playing around, Terrence.
You think I play like that?
Frankly, they all thought he was kidding. They thought he was blowing smoke at him. And then finally he said, come with me.
Come on, man. Man,
Steve tells detectives that when they arrived at the couple's apartment, everything took a dark turn.
He took them back to the apartment. They walked in, thought it was going to be some big joke, and unfortunately, they saw her.
Oh, I'm
No, what is this?
Steve says he and his friends started to panic. And at that point, Terrence demanded their help.
Steve says Terrence ordered the men to wrap Trina in a blanket, so they did.
Come on, get in there, man. Help me lift up, lift up.
Eventually, they managed to get her into the trunk of Terrence's car.
Steve said Terrence's plan was to drive Trina's body to Chicago and dump her there.
Terrence going to take her over here to Illinois because she's going to be a Jane Doe.
But Steve says that while Mark and Drew got in the car to go with Terrence, he had had enough.
He said, you're my buddy, but no, I'm not helping you. This is wrong.
Steve says that's when things escalated.
Terrence tried to get him to go with him to help, and he threatened him that you're going to end up like her.
He held his ground and refused to go, and eventually Terrence and his friends left.
He got the heck out of there as quickly as he could. The other friend actually wanted to do the same thing, but Terrence threatened him as well, so he didn't.
Detectives can't help but wonder why it took Steve so long to come forward, or why he agreed to help Terrence in the first place.
He was just in shock. You know, and he said he'd never seen a dead body like that. He did not know what to do at that point.
He said, I can't live with myself knowing what happened here. You guys got to do something.
But detectives still have one more question.
If what Steve was saying is true, then he wasn't there when Trina died. So detectives need to know how he's so confident it's murder and it wasn't an overdose or accident.
He kept saying, sorry, Trina. You know what I mean? Dude, sorry, Trina. Trina, I'm sorry.
He told us that Terrence had actually said, I killed her. But he didn't talk a lot about how he had killed her.
And you didn't see any blood?
No.
Detectives feel they are finally getting somewhere. They bring in both of Terrence's alleged accomplices, Drew Allen and Mark Raymond.
It didn't take much to get the two to talk to us. Once they realized they have some potential culpability, they told us exactly what they had done and what they had seen.
Both men tell detectives what they remember of where they had dumped Trina's body.
Both knew it was in Chicago on the south side.
They told them they didn't remember exactly where it was, but it was an abandoned house.
According to Mark and Drew, Trina is buried beside it.
They put her up under bushes and old tires and boards and stuff like that. And that's all they would say.
They didn't know the exact address. Terrence is the one who drove, and that's why they had a hard time. They were able to give us some benchmarks of different places that they remember passing. So it allowed us to at least get a general idea of where her body would be.
Given the statement by Terrence's accomplices, detectives no longer believe Sarah was involved.
She had been lied to by Terrence like everyone else. She turned out to be completely innocent. Detectives ask Chicago police to scour the south side of Chicago for Trina's body and roll the dice on charging Terrence Lee.
Terrence Lee was formally charged with murder.
But detectives will need to find Trina's body to secure a conviction against her husband.
They had FBI and the dogs and everything looking behind abandoned houses, up under boards and tires.
We were telling police departments, if you ever come upon a body, let us know right away.
As the weeks roll by, police get discouraged. Meanwhile, Terrence's attorney puts the pressure on.
In Indiana, if they file what's called a motion for a speedy trial, we have to try that person within 70 days. And if we don't, then they have to be released. He could be acquitted because of that.
With just 3 weeks until trial, there's still no sign of Trina's body.
That was a rough time. It was really rough for me. I remember having these one-on-ones with God and asking him to reveal, you know, where she is, you know.
As the search stalls, Trina's family suspects Terrence might just get away with murder again.
People were afraid that he would be released.
October 23rd, 2012. 2 months after Trina Winston disappeared, her husband's trial for her murder is inching closer. There's just one problem. Police haven't found Trina.
I've prosecuted hundreds, literally, of homicides in my career. That is the only case where I filed charges when I did not have a body.
After 10 weeks with no luck in the search, the tide finally changes.
Police in Chicago received an anonymous call of a suspicious smell at an abandoned house on the south side of town.
They dispatched an officer to go investigate.
He came upon what he believed to be a body.
53, I'm gonna need major crimes.
The body's in a state where she's not readily identifiable.
However, when South Bend detectives learn of the Jane Doe discovered on the south side of Chicago, they suspect Trina has finally been found.
She was discovered beneath tires in the vacant lot.
That was in the same area. Our witnesses told us that they'd taken her.
Dental records confirm the truth.
It comes back that it was Trina Winston.
It just shook me up. I'm just in the middle of the floor and I'm crying.
The steal wasn't real. She's actually gone. No, we didn't want to believe that.
While the family reels from the devastating news, detectives and prosecutors continue building their case against Terrence. Unfortunately, when detectives look over the autopsy report, it appears Trina's body offers no clues to her cause of death.
There were no gunshot wounds. There were no stab wounds. We would have known those because gunshots can hit bone. Stabbing, you're going to hit bone.
There is also no clear evidence of strangulation or overdose, making the prosecution's job that much more difficult.
Typically, an autopsy can reveal damage to the bone, even in a case like this one, where the body wasn't found until it was badly decomposed.
However, not in Trina's case.
The hyoid bone from the larynx was itself in too far of a state of decomposition to make that determination.
The toxicology report for overdose also comes back unclear.
The chief coroner came to the conclusion that she had died of undetermined causes.
However, based on where detectives found the body, coupled with the statements of Terrence's accomplices, Trina's death is ruled a homicide.
Why would you dump somebody's body if they die of natural causes? You don't. You do that if you're trying to hide something.
I don't believe that Trina crawled under the tires and then died. Somebody had placed her there. Somebody had put the tires on top of her to, you know, hide the body.
But will that argument be enough to secure a murder conviction? On November 14th, 2012, the trial for Terrence Lee gets underway. The verdict will be up to a judge per the defense's request.
They asked for a bench trial instead of going in front of a jury. A jury may have a hard time not saying, well, if you killed somebody once, then may kill again. And so I think part of the idea was if they do a bench trial, the judge can kind of discount that.
Terrence Lee had requested a bench trial. It's a speedier trial than, say, a jury trial. You have the presentation just as you would in a regular trial. However, the judge, instead of a jury of 12, decides your innocence or guilt.
Trina's former husband seems confident of his chances.
He kept smiling at us and kept laughing at us.
He was nonchalant. Actually, he even turned around and said, I did not kill Trina.
I wanted to just jump over the seats at him. You know, when I just wanted to put my hands around his neck and just choke him. I wanted to do what he does to Trina. You know, they say he choked her to death. I want to choke him to death.
The prosecution portrays Trina's murder as an all too common tale of domestic abuse.
Unfortunately, like many domestic violence cases, she went back to him, back and forth.
However, Trina had finally had enough.
He realized he could no longer control her the way he was. She wanted to get away.
She had been in the process of filing for an annulment after he'd tried to kill her once before.
He had strangled her and left her for dead in her closet just a few months prior to her disappearance, but she was able to escape.
But according to prosecutors, Terrence wasn't about to let her go. On the night of August 15th, 3 days after she had moved out, Terrence called Trina and convinced her to meet him.
His cell records confirmed he was the person she spoke with moments before she left her friend's home.
Prosecutors theorize Terrence used Trina's past addiction issues against her.
She would leave for the drugs, and he knew that. And that's exactly how he caught her.
Okay.
Terrence picked her up from her friend's house, and the two went back to their shared apartment. And prosecutors assert that's where he revealed his true intentions.
Look, I want to talk about us.
No, Terrence, that's not why I'm here.
You think you can just leave me?
I can do whatever I want.
You won't ever get away from me.
Statistically, women who are in abusive relationships are most at risk when they try to leave their abuser.
While the cause of death wasn't determinable, prosecutors assert Terrence strangled Trina, just like he had months before.
She was killed in that apartment. Three people had seen her lying on the floor there. It'd be difficult to kill her in one place by himself, pick her up and transport her to his apartment just to lay her out on the floor, and then ask for people to help to move her ultimately to Chicago. You're not gonna do that.
To bolster their claims, prosecutors have Terrence's accomplices testify against him.
All three men had very similar stories about what had happened that night, so prosecutors were pretty sure that they were all telling the truth about the murder.
When it's the defense's turn, they do their best to show reasonable doubt.
We didn't have the physical forensic evidence to verify that she was strangled because her body had been so badly decomposed. And so their defense was, Judge, they didn't prove that he killed her.
It's a compelling argument, but in the end, the evidence against Terrence is enough to convict him.
He knowingly killed Trina Winston. We don't have to prove how you kill a person, just that you kill a person. And in this case, that's what we were able to do.
Terrence is sentenced to 65 years in prison. However, Trina's family believes the punishment does not fit the crime.
He gets three meals, he talks to people. I truly believe he's looking for ways to get out, and I don't think it's fair.
As for Terrence's accomplices, all were cleared in exchange for their testimonies against Terrence.
They made the decision not to charge them because they had cooperated, and those testimonies were key to getting this conviction.
Meanwhile, Trina's family can only try to move forward, but the grieving process is far from over.
It's good days and bad days, birthdays or Christmas. It's tough for all of us.
He just messed up our whole lives, the whole family.
I think about her smile, tears come to my eye. I miss her a lot, a lot.
Trina's loved ones hope that by continuously sharing her story, they can prevent others from suffering the same tragic fate.
We started an organization called Hear Our Tears. And it's educating people about domestic violence.
Come to our meeting. Learn about abuse. Learn how to get away from it. Learn how to distinguish the difference.
You know, unfortunately, my sister was taken away by this killer. But at the same time, I felt this great need to have a hub, a place of healing. So we have these meetings, and we talk about what is, you know, intervention, prevention, and education to eradicate domestic violence. And I think it takes a community. So I look at the whole picture of how we can, you know, get people's mind to think these behaviors and these acts of generational stuff and hurt and trauma, and how can we as a people come together for a better tomorrow? And we have to start somewhere. Nobody wants to talk about violence and abuse, but we hear it every day. Since we turn the TV or the radio on, that's what we hear continuously, because it's a great need in our community.
Whoever is mistreating you, do not love you, get out. Tell somebody. Quit trying to cover it up. Tell the truth so somebody can help you. Somebody can save your life.
Thank you.
you.